All right, going to our next unit module. We just finished assignment one, or we just submitted it. And we're going to continue with compositing, but instead of compositing a setting, we're going to composite a character, in this case, a creature. So we did landscape elements before. Now we're going to do figurative elements, things that are designed to be able to move, right, and express. We're going to start with a concept sketch. Again, this is a fantasy creature. It's a fantasy creature that's going to be going into your landscape that doesn't need to limit your design of your creature that much. Just like you're able to put Bugs Bunny and Michael Jordan together in the Space Jam movie, right? Your character, as long as the character is believable, it can be separately believable than your background, and it can still work as a concept. So if you did an underwater landscape, doesn't mean you need to necessarily do an underwater character. We can always show like your lava dragon drowning underwater, you know? So don't let it limit your creativity. We have another question of the day for this unit, which relates to the only required reading of the class, which is chapter 2 in our online textbook, right? And you'll find that link in the course outline. And this is where, because we're dealing so much with compositing, we really learn some actual facts about Creative Commons, about public domain, about fair use, and about copyright law as it relates to images and how they can be used. Our project for this unit is basically a collaged creature with the advances that compositing gives us for collage. So we're going to be able to build on our compositing skills so far. And we're going to be adding more to them, things like clone stamping, things like dodge and burn, being able to do more targeted lighting adjustments, and underneath it all, understanding how to keep anatomy feeling usable, you know, like weights being carried on a skeletal structure, so that we'll have the option to animate these creatures and that whatever we design here can be animated, isn't just stuck as a 2D still image. So question of the day 2 is here. You can look at that. It's not due until February 13th, so you have some time. But it is going to relate to our last project, to this project. There's a great little video that a student shared with me a while ago that might make it more engaging why these things matter. And then we're just going to move down through the unit to past student examples. So this is the kind of thing you can do with one of your creature composites when you've built it with anatomy in mind, right? So we start with a sketch. In this case, we are not going to sketch based on references we found. Rather, we're going to sketch and then think about what references would fit our needs. So I sketched this using what are called basic shapes. I'll show you that. And then I had to think about, well, what kind of animal things can I find online at high enough resolution that might fulfill this idea? And the reason you have to sketch first is it not only did I need to find a pig nose, but I had to find a pig nose at the right angle, right? Angles really matter for anatomy. And you need to sketch in such a way that your full creature's anatomy is understood. So it's usually a three-quarter view. It's not going to be in strict profile. It's not going to be head-on. You really want to understand what the character looks like from all sides, even though you're just showing it from one direction. On and on and on. And you can see past student examples more there. You can see past playlists looking for assignment 2. And then we get to the actual assignment. So just like our landscape, you're going to use at least 5 found creature compositions, like this found image from Pixabay. You want it to be at least 1,000 pixels in its smallest dimension, right? This one is almost 5,000 by 3,000 pixels. But it's not like you're going to be using all of this. You might use this for just the chin, or you might use this for just this spinal ridge, or you might use it just for the eye. It depends on what your vision is. So before we find those 5 sources, we need to sketch some inspiration. And we're going to sketch Well, I'm gonna encourage you, especially if you're new to creature design, to look at Pokemon, especially early Pokemon design, because they go through like eras where they got way too complicated and they didn't have clean silhouettes, and then they got better again. But when you look at just these silhouettes, you know, just these shapes, you kind of know how that creature moves because of the way they're using the silhouette, right? Whether they're based on a caterpillar or a snake or a fox or a bird, these are all kind of imagined beings that then you can just use as inspiration for your own sketch. So here's a past student example that does this well. There's the Pokemon they were inspired by. That's the silhouette of that Pokemon. This was their finished project. That's the silhouette of the project. So you can see that even though they created this all on their own, the silhouette was incredibly inspiring and instructional for them to get a creature that really felt like it could move and have dimensionality. So how do we do this? I give you some steps on what I need you to do for next class. So this is what we need to sketch. Rough basic shapes for a fantasy creature. In a pose, perhaps using Pokemon shapes as inspiration, that is like a Pokemon pose. That's not just straight on, not just straight silhouette. So it's usually going to be kind of a three-quarter view. Then you're going to brainstorm the animals you might use to fulfill that. You know, in this case, a duck, a pangolin, an axolotl. I took student suggestions and they make it kind of tough. And a tortoise. Then based on what you can actually find, we're going to rough cut and place those just like we did with landscape elements, right? And then we're going to refine, try to cut them out a little bit better. And then we will use some of these new techniques, things like clone stamping and dodging and burning, to get it all to sync together within that silhouette. So this is what we need to work on and bring in for next class. So how do we start that? We've only got a few minutes, so I'm going to open up. I'll sketch digitally, but the same way we did with our landscape. I'm just going to do a regular 8x10x350. I'm going to use my tablet. Use a regular brush that's pressure sensitive for size. And on the default black. And I'm ready to sketch. Okay. So, I find it helpful to be inspired by Pokemon. So I'm going to look up a Pokédex. Whether you have any familiarity with Pokemon or not, you can just look up images of them. I actually give you a link. I don't want an image of a Pokédex. I actually give you a link in the assignment to one, but you can find others. Where is it? I don't. I think that link expired maybe, but I can just use this one, even though there are, I think, over 1,000 Pokemon now. And think, what's a shape I'm kind of interested in? I'm in a candy land. I kind of want to do something kittenish, kind of cutesy. Or maybe I go the opposite of that. Maybe something reptilian and weird. So let's see. Oh, I kind of like this one. One that looks like a bowl of mud. I'm zoomed in a lot. So you can take your time and find your inspiration, or if you're already in love with certain fantasy creatures from mythology or from Dungeons and Dragons or from cartoons, you might use that as your own inspiration. But you're going to do your own version of it. So if I'm inspired by this guy, I might do a little screen grab of that guy and put him onto my sketch, right, to help inform it. And now I'm going to start with the skeleton, the vertebrate parts of the sketch. So you always start with the focal point of a vertebrate creature, which is going to be the cranium, the thing that holds their brain. And so basic shapes are circles, triangles, rectangles. And that's basically it. But I add what's called a wedge shape to speed things up. So I'll show you that I can draw this all with circles, ovals, triangles, rectangles, squares, and wedges. So I'm going to draw the cranium shape, which is very elliptical. And then I'm going to show where kind of the eyes are placed. And they're, I'm going to make them somewhat like soft triangles. And that shows me the angle of the head. These are called direction lines on a head. Like if you were to draw a line right down the middle of your face and then a line right across your eyes, that shows you the angle that the head is facing. It's a three-quarter angle. Then he has this big jaw like this. So this is going to be kind of the calorie monster that lives in Candyland, I guess. Right. But the trick is I need to actually find things to make this creature out of. But I like that proportion change of the cranium to what's called the mandible. So the mandible is this neck shape just made with these ovals that are cut off. Then I have a big wedge shape for the neck and chest. And then I want to find, this is where it's important, where the spine would be that connects that cranium to the collarbone. And the collarbone is the thing that connects the arms. So the collarbone is here, and then here's one shoulder. The other shoulder is behind the mouth. So you draw like you're seeing it in an x-ray. You draw through for your basic shapes. So from that shoulder joint comes an oval, and then kind of a triangular shape for the hand. It's about that big. Same thing from this. Notice how wide the space is between these shoulders. That's going to matter when I composite. I've got an oval. I don't really have elbows, but I could always build them in like a stick figure. Elbows, and then another kind of squarish shape for that hand. And then I've got underneath the rib cage, which is here, right? The belly and kind of skirt, which is another soft triangle or wedge that comes in like this. So now this is the tricky part. What does this make me think of? Because this looks like mud and this looks like rock. That's not going to work really well for a believable creature anatomy. I want anatomical things. So a creature whose head is kind of round and big-eyed like this, I think of maybe a beetle. Like maybe what's a really big beetle? I don't know, but I'll find one. So a big beetle head. Then for this mouth, what kind of creature has just a huge open mouth? Hippo. Monkey's good, like a howler monkey. A hippo is great. I'll put them both in. It's always good to have options. And then a big, heavy, triangular, thick neck that goes into a big shoulder base. Yeah, like a cow, bovine, maybe buffalo, bison. That's what's really fun is when we get to kind of mix textures here. You know, like a beetle texture, a hippo texture, a bison's fur. So maybe bison shoulders. And then these arms, maybe rhinoceros for these like kind of plated heavy. Why do I not say hippo arms? Well, hippos are mostly underwater. It's not easy to find images of underwater creatures that are above water, right? Whereas rhinoceroses are above water and similar. And then under here, maybe this is where I bring some of the rock idea in. Maybe I look for lava flows. Ooh, or a slug. Yeah, kind of a Jabba the Hutt kind of inspiration, right? And that might lead me down some interesting image sourcing, right? So when I start looking for images, which is the next step, and the other thing I want you to do before next class is look for some images that are more than 1,000 pixels, is I'm not only looking for the thing that's going to give me what I want, I'm also looking for the right direction. Because if I get a beetle head, but it's not angled this way, I can't really change that angle if the pixels aren't there, right? I can flip it,